professional help.
Sports Betting Weekly.
Sports Betting Weekly, sponsored by EasySportsData.com. The books use data, shouldn't you too? And this is Easy Sports Data, like the preschoolers use. EasySportsData.com.
I win here and I win there. Now what?
Sports Betting Weekly.
I want to win!
Here we go. Money talk. Here comes
the money. You should also check out sportsbettinglessons.com. You'll learn some old tricks because sometimes how you bet is more important than who you bet. Sportsbettinglessons.com.
Let's just do it. Let's meet this thing head on. And you were in it to win it.
What about an education?
Sports Betting Weekly.
Wow, winning.
Sports Betting Weekly.
Sit back and enjoy the show.
Winner, winner, chicken.
Welcome to Sports Betting Weekly and Happy New Year. It has been a couple weeks since we talked with any of our opinionators, and they really had a phenomenal 2020. We started 2020 talking about these same games that we're talking about in 2021. And then, as you all know, something happened. It kind of changed the world for everybody. But at Sports Betting Weekly, we kind of just kept going. We chipped away. We had Paolo come on. Now, Paolo is from Greece. He's in Canada, and he is a soccer expert. He's a very, very good handicapper in all sports. But in soccer, as you know, everybody else in the world bets soccer, but Americans. He was really, really good at it. So for 7, 8, 9 weeks, all we had was soccer and horse racing to talk about. And guess what we did? We cashed tickets. It's going to be no different in 2021. We are blessed to have 7 football games that are high-quality football games to talk about this weekend. We're going to hear from John at GMF Sports Consultants. If everything goes well, Blackhawk West will join us. We're going to talk about a lot of things. But before we do that, it's a real simple contest. If you can pick the final score of Monday's national championship game exactly, then all you have to do is go to send an email to show at sportsbettingweekly.com. In the subject, you put your team, the winning team, and the score. In the body of that email, you put your name, and guess what? You'll be entered, and the winner gets a premium display case souvenir football of the national championship. Actually, it could be any football you want. If you want to hold off because you're a pro fan and you want to wait and see who wins the Super Bowl, it doesn't matter. We've used our contest with the championshipfootballs.com, with the guys at Worldwide Sports Radio Network, and with the guys at Belly Up Sports, and it just worked out really, really well, mostly because they're the coolest present they'll open that day, and it's guaranteed. And when we say guaranteed, we've been doing this for 12 years. We ain't had to send one back yet or get one shipped back to us yet. So let's do this. We got John on the phone. We have not heard from Wes yet, but what we're going to do, John, is we're going to, A, talk a little bit about what happened in the past, and then the first segment, we're going to hop on the national championship game Monday. The second segment, we're going to hop on Saturday's wildcard weekend, and Sunday will be the last segment after break because we have a unique setup this year, don't we?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Very now, cool how they set up all the playoff games and everything. So,
imagine a lot of things that happened this year because of the pandemic are going to change how those things are done forever. I got to think that this is going to be no different with the NFL. They're going to make some changes, and so is college football. They're going to make changes because some of the things that didn't happen this year, you didn't really miss them. And some of the things that didn't happen, you really did miss. So I think that's going to help everybody. And it's not like they've made a lot of changes in the NFL recently. These are some major changes when you're talking about one team getting a bye and everybody else having to play.
Yeah, definitely. That's probably the biggest thing here is you see that the number 2 seed, which normally, you know, gets that bye week, they got to play this week, which is strange. So, I mean, it's good for us, for the guys who like to bet and for the guys who like to watch football, because then, you know, we kind of get those extra games in there. So it's very interesting to see how this plays out, you know, with the extra team and that number 2 seed, you know, kind of playing on the first week here.
All right, so now I got a text from Blackhawk West that says he's in.
Okay.
But I'm not seeing him on the board. But this is our first week with this new program, StreamYard. And StreamYard, if you guys do your own podcast or you do any shows, the StreamYard thing is pretty cool. It really does. It offers a lot more options. But it's new to me, so I'm not quite sure where Blackhawk Wes is. So let me see if I can find him anywhere. So he's not there. There you are.
There's me.
Out there. That's me.
He's lost in the internet.
Here. He's lost.
He's lost in the cloud out there.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you the floor, and I'm going to ask you two questions that you can answer while I talk to Wes and see if we can find him. One is, did you do much bowl game betting? And B, did you have any success? And number two is, do you have any opinions on Monday? Go get him.
Okay. Yeah, no. For the actual bowl games that we had previously, I kind of really steered away from them. You know, as we kind of touched on the previous shows and podcasts that we did, college football was extremely tough for me this year. So I really didn't play too much. And it's a good thing because some of the plays that I liked wind up, you know, going the other way. So as far as a championship game, I probably will give out a play and I'll probably lay something on it. It won't be anything significant. But, you know, both these teams, both Alabama and Ohio State are extremely good, very good offensively. We all know kind of the backstory of Alabama and everything like that. So it's kind of hard, you know, to shy away from them. I haven't even really looked at the spread or anything like that, but I would probably lean towards Alabama going into this game just because, I mean, they've been here so many times. But Ohio State is extremely talented. You know, nothing to take away from Ohio State. They beat a really good Clemson team, really, really good Clemson team. So,
yeah, I told everybody, I don't think – Ohio State can beat Alabama, but you need a little asterisk next to that because the same exact words came out of my mouth when we were talking about Clemson, and they beat Clemson up. Clemson couldn't stop them. They just kept scoring and scoring and scoring and scoring.
Yeah, definitely. It was probably one of the worst games I think I've seen Trevor Lawrence play, you know, since he's been at Clemson. He looked way off, and I don't know if that was because of him or maybe just because – the Ohio State, you know, defense played extremely well too and was able to kind of, you know, limit the players that they had. But he looked really off. And I mean, Fields was playing incredible. Ohio State just seemed to be clicking on all cylinders. You know, they made all the big plays at the right time. And, you know, Clemson never seemed to really kind of get any sort of momentum or really, you know, get anything going, you know, where you could feel like they were in charge of that game at any point.
No, I agree. Now, when we talk about the bowl games this year, it was definitely a unique situation, not having the fans. And I watched a lot of the games, and it was hard for me. I know in the beginning, all you had to do was look at the team record. The first seven or eight games, you just bet the team with a better record and you won the game. Yep. But game, there were 4-4 teams and a 3-4 team, and you look, if you go to championshipfootballs.com and you look at the championship ball that we've made for Ohio State, if they win and they are national champions, they're going to be 8-0, and that's something you would have saw in 1932. Navy was 8-0. So it's crazy. So we finally got Blackhawk West. There he is. Look
there
at
he
him.
Is.
Happy New Year, my man.
You the same.
Happy New Year. Happy New Year.
You too, John.
I'm gonna let you answer the two questions that I asked John. One is, did you make many plays on the bowl games, and if you did, how did you do? And then B. Well, or number two was, do you have an opinion on Monday? But now you're an Ohio State fan. You have you name your pets after Ohio State people. So it may not necessarily, but I've known you, Wes, a long, long time now, and I know that you are able to separate. Sloppy and you were very, very good at separating your heart from your head. Some people can't do that.
Yeah, most of the time you walk away from your own team because you just know them better than – and you know the names, and they're on the local news, and they're in the community. But I definitely made money off Ohio State last week, and I certainly made money off bowls. Although this bowl season was more challenging because there was a lot more game time opt outs than what we had seen in the past, and there wasn't a great pattern to follow as to what those opt outs would even mean. And, you know, the bowl season started off looking like the SEC didn't want to play. And then it finished where, you know, SEC, I think they finished 4-2. So it kind of shaped up the way it should. Indiana was a little disappointing, but it didn't surprise me very much. But, you know, the bowl games, all in all, this was a harder season because normally you get one game a day. We had a lot of bowl days where it was three games in a day and it felt like an NFL day. So going one game to the next, and if you lost that first one, chasing it in the second one, you didn't really have much time to recover. But I did pretty well. As far as this Ohio State and Bama game coming up, the only number I'm really confident in, because as a fan, I'm going to try and put that aside as I'm talking about the game. The only number I'm really confident in, same number I texted you last week, that first half spread, that first half team over is 16.5 Ohio State right now. I think they're going to score 17 points. There's going to be a lot of points in this game. The Bama defense shown that they will allow points, and Ohio State is happy to score them. I wouldn't be surprised to see the first half go 21-17 either way.
Yeah, I'm losing a little bit of your audio. I heard you. It's kind of faint, so I don't know if you moved your mic around. But I will give you a shout-out because I told people what you said about Ohio State, and my son's in Brazil now. He's traveling. He's in Brazil. So I know he won because I put the bet in for him. Now, I had Clemson, but I made sure and get his bet on the over team total Ohio State first half, and easy winner just doesn't describe it. It was like, 7 minutes in, I think they cashed.
They've never not done that. As far back as I could remember, they've never not scored 14 points in the first half. So that 14.5 or that 13.5, I think, is what it was. You had to pay some juice for the 13.5, but they've never not done that. It just, there was so much disrespect both out of Vegas and out of Clemson, and really the public going into that game. You can't give a well-coached, great roster like that fuel.
No, and again, I was on that side of the equation, so I, you know, and I told you that, you know, I'm wrong a lot, but I'm wrong, and because of live action. Now, this morning, I got called a bad name on the internet. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not the first person to get called a bad name, but you both have known me for a while. I don't do many things that deserve name calling because I don't really care about enough stuff to get emotionally involved with. But it was a situation with the guy gave out his play of the day was Kentucky, and it was a loser. It was Wednesday night, I guess, maybe yesterday. Anyway, they were down. They were given, I think they were given 7, maybe 9. They were given 7 or 9, and they were down with a minute to go in the first half. They were down by 9. They must have been given 7. They were down by 9. Well, that's a money live action play right there. And they, at halftime, they ended up coming back and they won the game by 3, so that would have cashed. And at halftime, they were given 9.5, and they won the second half by 13 or 14. So I said to the guy, you know, not for nothing, that's good handicapping. That's just bad betting, because if it was Paolo or if it was Wes, they would have hit 2 plays out of 3. So you went 0-1, they went 2-1, and usually, not always, but usually 2-1 is better than 0-1. And he couldn't handle that. And sometimes people just can't handle the truth. I realize that. But that is the one thing that I got lucky with the bowl game, and lucky is a relative term. I had a lot of live plays because you could kind of see that it wasn't a bowl season to be betting before the games, because like I said, you didn't know who was going to play. And then when the guys bowed out, you really didn't know how important that was. But if you start watching, you realize, you know what, the guy that left, this is not much better than the guy that replaced him. And on college rosters, sometimes that happens.
The other thing that made this bowl season particularly challenging is normally you can look at a 10 or a 11 or 12 game stretch and find some comp opponents, but they only played the conferences. So that made it even more difficult because you couldn't compare the brother of the brother to the money line. So
it was an apple orange bowl game season, no doubt about it. And then the other aspect is I always like to say, hey, what did they do on the road? Because a bowl game is a road game. And then you look at some of these teams that two road games. You know, Ohio State had 2 road games, I think. Yeah. So, I mean, you're not going to get a real good read on somebody with 2 road games. But one of the things that I looked at when I talked to myself, and I do that quite frequently, and really – sometimes I actually argue. Well, usually I get along with myself pretty well. What I noticed was there's 2 games that jumped out at me. The Ohio State Northwestern game and the Alabama-Florida game. Those are the two games that I think, if I'm coaching, those are the teams, those are the games that are going to make me know what it takes, because it's the only game that Ohio State didn't score, and it's the only game that Alabama gave up, you know, a bazillion points. So it'll be interesting to see what happens, but we both know that good coaching and that extra time makes a difference, and these two teams are going to have now a week and a half.
They are. They are going to have a week and a half. You know, to the point you were making earlier about the about that the Kentucky play, you know, the days of having to call your guy and lay your action and hope for the best, I mean, those days are long gone. There's a lot of ways to either further your win or save yourself and switch to the other side. There is nothing honorable about, you know, taking the loss and chasing a little bit further. I mean, you can read the games. Live betting is there. You may as well use it. Sometimes it feels like cheating, but I'm still able to take that win to pay my cell phone bill with, you know?
Yeah, and now this week we're not going to deal with it because we're just going to try to cover these games, do our best to seven games is not a lot, but seven quality games is a lot. But starting next Thursday, we're going to go back to live action because you're absolutely right. If you're only betting the game, well, you know how I feel about people like that. I've actually called them names in the past, and I was wrong, and I do apologize for calling you names. It's your money. If you want to burn it, burn it. If you want to throw it out the car window going down the freeway, you got to do what you got to do. You've earned that money. It's your money. When it's my money, I'm a little smarter with my money. Sometimes the handicapping, well, always the handicapping is what happened in the past, and what's happened in the present is what you're seeing, and that's what you react to. So, Wes, you and I have done that very well. You look at John. John, you do very, very good with your handicapping, but you've already told us that a very small fraction of that is live action. If you even add a little bit more, just think what you could do, because if you could, if just half of your losers, say you go 6-4, 6-4, nothing to be wrong with. 7-3 is even better, but 6-4 is nothing wrong with that. But then you could take two of those four and turn around and cash tickets on them. Well, all of a sudden now, you're 8-4. Same handicapping. 8-4 is better than 6-4. It's even better than 7-3. It's probably even with 7-3. If they put that on my tombstone, if I'm not here tonight, as a matter of fact, and my wife watches this show, she won't have to watch the show. You guys are going to have to call her. You two callers, you got to watch the show because Chaz says he's got something he wants to put on the tombstone. Just right, live action is where it's at, because that's really what if I could have it. I don't do tattoos, but that would be a tattoo I would put on me.
Oh, yeah, definitely. The live action, I feel, is kind of the only advantage that really us as players really kind of have. And especially this year, I've been getting into it, you know, way more than I previously have in the past. And just like how Wes was kind of saying, you know, those days of kind of calling your guy and just sitting on the book, like that's, you know, that's changed. We got everything in the palm of our hand. And, you know, with the way technology is and what these online books offering this, I almost think like now just watching it, depending on what side of the line you're on, if you just watch it, you can almost get yourself a better line if you just wait a couple minutes, you know, depending on what you're doing into the game. And you can find yourself almost better odds, you know, if you wait a little bit or kind of, like you said, kind of just continue on to, you know, continue in that action. So.
Yeah, we talk, and Wes and I talk about that all the time. We establish a number before the game. And if it's even close, I'm going to have some action early because I want to at least catch a ticket. But sometimes a right could be the game was 7, the first half is 4, they win the first half by 6, but they're the better team. So if you waited, you might not cash that first half ticket. So I'm going to cash that first half ticket. Then I want to hit him again live. Then I'll hit him again at the second half. And if I could get 3, 4, 5, now I know Wes had a baseball game where he cashed like 9 tickets in like 3 But if I can get a game where I cash 3 or 4, I've had 5 or 6 tickets, and it could be on the point spread, could be on the over. I did have a game where I needed one more touchdown, and I would have hit 5 bets because I won the 2.5. I won the 3.5. I had 5.5, and I had 7.5, and they kneeled on me. They kneeled on me. They kneeled on, like, the 3-yard line, and they ran out the clock with the last 3 plays of kneels. And, of course, that's why they call a gambling. What are you going to do? But when we come back from break, what we're going to do is we're going to slide out of the college game, and we're going to talk a little bit about our contest, and we're going to make sure both of our guests get their plays in for our Monday night Pick the Final Score contest. We're going to talk about Wild Card Weekend. You are listening to Sports Betting Weekly on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network and the Belly Up Podcast Network.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Edward Lehman has been a trusted insurance advisor for over 16 years with insurance solutions for auto, home, commercial, life, and retirement. He's located at 54 Sunnyside Boulevard, Suite H in Plainview. That's just 1,000 feet south of 495. Local agent, local advice. The time to think about insurance is before you need it. So do yourself a favor, and before you pay your next insurance bill, give Ed and his team a call, 516-935-3900, or visit him online at www.allstate.com/EL. Edward H. Lehman Insurance is your trusted insurance advisor.
Do current market conditions have you nervous? Our experienced team of financial professionals at Heritage Harbor Financial Associates understands that no two investors are alike. We all have different goals, needs, and appetites for risk. That's why the one-size-fits-all approach does not work, especially when planning for retirement. At Heritage Harbor Financial Associates, we analyze your unique investment style so that you can work toward your individual retirement goals on your terms. Heritage Harbor Financial Associates can help you take steps to reach your retirement goals by providing a wide array of financial products to fit your needs, even for the risk adverse. Give us a call at 631-331-6599 to learn more or to set up an appointment with one of our financial professionals. You can also find us on the web at hhfa.org or on Facebook at facebook.com/hhfa.org. Our number again is 631-331-6599. That's 631-331-6599. Investments in stocks, bonds, and mutual funds and variable annuities are not FDIC insured and are subject to fluctuation in value market risk, including loss of principal. Heritage Harbor Financial Associates offers securities through AXA Advisors, LLC, New York, New York. Member FINRA, SIPC. Annuity and insurance products offered through AXA Network, LLC.
Be fearless at MMA Long Island and Setuha Karate. Located at 28 Cold Court in Ronkonkoma, MMA Long Island is the martial arts school for you if you want to learn combat-proven techniques. Build confidence, discipline, and self-esteem while learning real martial arts to fight back against bullies, predators, and peer pressure. MMA Long Island offers group and private lessons for all ages and levels in traditional Goju-Ryu Karate, MMA, and self-defense. MMA Long Island is one of Long Island's most affordable martial arts schools. There are no promotion, belt, or membership fees, and family discounts are available. All classes are taught by 7th degree black belt Sensei John Benedict with over 30 years teaching experience. So whether you want to get in the ring or protect yourself and your family, MMA Long Island can help you reach your goals. Visit MMALongIsland.com. That's MMALongIsland.com or call or text 516-381-9660. That's 516-381-9660.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Sports Betting Weekly.
Yeah, you know what? We suffered a pandemic cancellation. The Sports Betting Weekly annual Betaway Weekend in Las Vegas has been canceled due to the COVID-19 situation. Now, we were just there, spent some time with John. I had a good time, but it is what it is. There's not much you can do about it. You have to stay safe. We're in California. We're not actually supposed to leave the house. But with a good mobile account, guess what? I really don't need to leave the house. The only problem, of course, and we talk about this on Sports Betting Weekly all the time, is the state of California has some issues. And until they rectify that situation, none of the losses that I give them or give to my account are going to go to them. So we'll see what happens. All right, Wes, we're having a contest.
Let's do it.
You have to pick the exact total for the Monday night game. You have go to show at sportsbettingweekly.com, which is just the show's email, and you put in the subject. You don't have to do it right now, but in the subject, you put the team. So I put Alabama and then the score, and I think I went with 44 to 27. Now, of course, you probably don't agree with that, but that's what I did. And then in the body of the email, I just put my name, second half Chaz, and that's all we're looking for. You send an email to show at sportsbettingweekly.com. In the subject, you put the team you think is going to win and the score you think the final score is going to be. In the body, you put your name, and that's how you enter. And when you win, you will get, and for you, this would be pretty cool, because I would assume the word Ohio State's going to come first in your subject, whereas mine was Alabama. You're going to get an Ohio State Buckeyes 2020. That'll be their ninth time national champions. Ohio State Buckeyes souvenir football. It really will be the coolest gift you'll receive that day, and we pretty much guarantee it. All right, so we're going to go back to getting John on here. And what we're looking at is a couple things. One is Saturday. We got three games Saturday. Mm-hmm. In terms of these games, now, I know, John, you don't always go ahead. You haven't gotten to Sunday yet, you said, right?
Because it's the playoffs in NFL, I actually looked ahead. So I actually looked at Saturday's games will probably be what we're focusing on right now. You want to know what? I said this before. The playoffs are really, really tough. Defenses are on point. You know, the possessions really matter. So it's really tough betting these. So just for me and my team personally, as far as a betting scale, we're probably going down to like half units on these playoff games. These are almost something where this is the end of the year. Why I say this is a time to kind of enjoy and watch these games, because they're really, really good games. These are playoff teams for a reason. So sit back, relax, enjoy the games. And, let's think about the season that we had. But, yeah, we're really kind of tailing off as far as unit-wise come for the playoffs. But I did look ahead for NFL, so there are a couple games.
If you're new to sports betting, okay, and you think that you can enjoy games, I would say out of 10 games that I bet, maybe two of them I get to enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
The other eight will rip your stomach to shreds. I mean, we're talking Pepto-Bismol gambling. And you could have that happen and go 7-3, because it's especially with some sports, but football is definitely one of them. And one of the things we talked about with that live action, and John brought it up, the house is just so good at it. They're so good at the line. They're just so very good that you really, before the game, they have all the advantage. But once the game starts, all they can do is set the line based on what's happening. And then all of a sudden now we're kind of both equal because we're both watching the game, you know? So we're going to do that. We're going to start, and we're going to do kind of a round robin. We'll do a loop. Now, I don't know how it works on your screen, but on my screen, I'm on the left, then it's Wes, then it's John. So we're going to start with me. We're going to go through all six games. This segment, we're going to go through the three Saturday games, and we're going to just talk a little bit about each game. And I'm going to be kind of brief. Indy at Buffalo. I'm telling you right now, Buffalo is as good a football team, especially on offense, that I have seen. And they've won me some money, so I'm a little prejudiced, because you know how you send one of your kids better than the other if they're a good kid and you got one kid that's a bad kid. Buffalo is just a very, very, very good football team, and I would not be surprised if they win a few games here in the next few weeks. What do you think about that, Wes?
So I'm on the other side of that one. I actually spent more time on this game than any of the others, and there's a couple reasons. What I really like Indy rushing attack versus Buffalo's rush defense. I started to look at takeaways and giveaways. Of the teams that are remaining, Buffalo is in the top three in both takeaways and giveaways. Indy also takes the ball away pretty well, but they're one of the stingiest teams as far as giving the ball away. So as far as this game goes, I really think that it's gonna be Indy. I'm actually taking the points, but I'm also laying full units, laying points on Indy. I'm laying three. I'm laying 3.5. I'm laying 1.5. And I'm all over Indy on this game. I think their rush attack, their O-line and D-line is going to be just too much against Buffalo.
What do you think, John?
So, yeah, this is kind of a similar situation where, like you were saying, the Buffalo has been extremely good to me over the course of the year. So I almost feel like I'm kind of stuck into betting them. What Wes was saying is the same thing that scares me. I'm going to bet Buffalo. I'm going to bet them at -6. I'm taking this really, really small. Indianapolis defense is extremely, extremely tough. And that running game is also very, very good. Those were the two things that really concerned me about this. This game, I feel, can go either way. I'm taking Buffalo just because, like you said, that's kind of been my baby that I've been cradling in my arms, you know, throughout the season. So I'm going to kind of show it a little bit of love here. But this is extremely, extremely tough game. I do believe, though, Buffalo is probably the second best team in the AFC behind Kansas City. But it's going to be tough. I think this is going to be an extremely tough. If they can get past Indy, I think they have a really good shot versus KC. But yeah, it's the experience is on the Indianapolis side. They got a lot of veterans. You know, Buffalo, you know, Josh Allen is going to have to continue to play well. You know, the wide receivers Diggs is going to have to make plays, and that's pretty much where it stands. So it's going to be tough, but I'm going to take Buffalo for a little bit, and then I might even utilize that end game. Let's say Indy scores a quick touchdown. Maybe Buffalo gets, you know, maybe I'll get some love on the end game on the Buffalo side for that too. So definitely something to look for.
Well, then that's a perfect situation. Now, if it was a jury, they would throw me off the jury selection because I would say, hey, I've had to watch Philip Rivers for the last 20 years. There's turnovers coming. It's just a matter of when, not if. But I will give him his props because he did really well. Obviously, the Chargers made the right call too because that kid is really special. But the one thing about that live action is you're absolutely right. You guys could both win. If everything goes well in live action, Wes could win with the Colts, and John can win with Buffalo on the same game. And that's really very hard to do usually. The house is pretty good at what they do. But with live action, that is possible. And a second game in the afternoon is the Rams at Seattle. You know what? They played recently, and the comment I said to somebody, and it was just last week or the week before Seattle beat him, and I said, coaching. You know what? There's two things. You look at quarterback and you look at coaching. And in this team, Seattle gets both the check marks for me. I like Seattle.
I'm with you on this one, Chaz. I really like Seattle in this game. And I went back to the game that the Rams actually beat Seattle. They've actually played each other twice this year. And the Rams have sacked Russell Wilson 11 times in two games. And so this past game where they beat them, where the Seattle beat the Rams by 11, Russell Wilson was on his back five times. That's huge. But in the first game, it took six sacks and two Russell Wilson interceptions for the Rams to beat Seattle. And I believe Seattle was not playing with Ramsey at that point. He's made a huge difference on their defense. And now we're looking at the Rams, where we got a thumb injury and a starting quarterback. So we're either looking at a backup quarterback or a starting quarterback that's coming off a thumb. 3.5 feels like a gift. I love Seattle.
What do you think, John? Did I mute you? Hold on.
There we go. Okay. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, I'm on the same. I'm on the same side with Seattle. Obviously, the injury. You know, the Rams have been relentless to kind of say who the starter is. I think even if Goff does play, I still like Seattle in this situation. As Wes was saying, their defense has played, you know, extremely better the last couple of weeks. The running game has seemed to be going, and it seems like Russell has kind of got away from kind of doing too much. That previous game where they played against the Rams, you could tell he was forcing the ball. The two interceptions really made a difference. So I like Seattle. Obviously, the experience is there. And like you said, the coaching, that's you got to go with the experience and the coaching. So,
well, their Seattle defense had to get better, right? It was horrible. Yeah. It was horrible.
Oh, it was horrible. They were getting beat for big, big yardage. And I think that was kind of the trap that Russell Wilson fell into. It was like they have to score 30, 40 points every game. But now I think he's kind of reserved and played his game. We all know DK Metcalf, one of the best wide receivers I feel in a game. You know, we got Carson, we got the running backs there. So I think he'll be able to kind of, you know, play his more style of game, kind of sit back, relax, adjust to what the defense is giving them. The Rams have a really good defense. There's no doubt about it. Their defense is going to have to play extremely well because I don't think their offense is going to be able to keep them in this game. So we'll see how it plays out. But I got to give the edge to the Seahawks with Russell, the coach.
There's no doubt that Ram front seven is good. I mean, the Donald, right? He gets double teamed constantly. And yet he still makes plays. The other guys makes plays. And it really is one of the plays that I'm leaning and looking at is the under in that game for that reason. And that is another play that we haven't talked about. But almost always with these games, if I have a lean, I'm going to try to play the parlay. As you know, that's another house advantage. Sometimes they don't allow you to play the parlay. And it's kind of, you know, duh. Just when I have a chance of winning, you take it away from me. But it's kind of what they do. The last game, Saturday night, is Tampa Bay, and it is Washington. Now, Tampa Bay, better record, but they're playing at the team formerly known by a different name because they won the coveted NFC East. Now, I know one of us, and I'm going to not mention any names, Blackhawk West, doesn't bet games that have NFC East players in it. Because you just don't do it, and you're a genius. Because this year was a proof of why you're a genius. But what do you think?
Well, it's NFC East matchups. So any combination of those four teams against each other. This game was a hard one for me because when I look at Tampa, they get sacked a ton. Brady is under a ton of pressure all the time. And when I look at Washington, they've had 50 sacks on the season. They're one of the most under talked about D lines in football. I think currently where we sit, Washington's got a much better coach. Where my investing side is on this game is I like the under. It's 44.5. I think it'll be 45 by kickoff. But where I see it is I don't think that Washington's going to be able to score points because Tampa's defense is pretty good. Alex Smith is just built to light it up. They're averaging like, I think it's under 20 points a game, but it's not going to take but 24 points to beat Washington. So when you go there, when they only need to score 24 points or 27 points, somewhere around there, that leaves a very narrow margin from zero to that 24 for that 8.5 spread. So I'm playing the under in this game because I don't think Washington will help Tampa score points to go over 45 or 44. But I believe that the points is a smarter play in this just because that's a lot of points for a team that's going to sack a quarterback a lot. And you know, one out of those three sacks, Brady just might give the ball up. So 8.5 feels good. It might be 9 by kickoff. So I'm not playing the Washington, but that's the side I would lean if I was picking a team in this game. I'm playing the under.
There you go, John.
Yeah, this is a game, as far as betting wise, I'm staying away from kind of the same sentiments that Wes said. Washington, the front four and the front seven is going to give Brady trouble. And we all know how much Brady struggles with the four and the seven when they're extremely aggressive. I think he's going to get into trouble where, you know, Brady's not a great runner. And you can kind of tell this season more than others when he's forcing these passes, he throws a lot of interceptions. I don't like that 8. I definitely would not recommend anybody take Tampa Bay at the 8. You know, call me crazy. I heard a whole bunch of people saying Tampa Bay is going to blow out Washington. I really don't see that happening. Washington has a really, really good run game. McKissick has been good. I think what obviously Alex Smith, he's going to be able to slow the game down. This is something I'm not touching. I'll watch it. I'll enjoy the game, but I'm staying away from that. Do I think Tampa Bay will win? Probably. They have a better offense. But, you know, Washington has been playing extremely well, as good as Washington can be in that division. So I think the defense is going to give them trouble. So,
well, I'll let you know that I did not win betting on Washington in the second half in week 17. I got a push. It was the first time they haven't covered for me in 2 months. Mm-hmm. They have won every single second half that they have played. Now, I believe teams that do well in the second half are good teams. Because that's good coaching. That's good adjustments and stuff. So I'm telling you right now, if this game is a blowout in the first half, that leads right to playing Washington in the second half. Yep. If this game is close at halftime, it's because what you guys have said. They're pressuring it. And Vicky, because we're Charger fans, well, Vicky was a Charger fan before she became a Ravens fan, but that's because they packed up and left for London. She screams, "Put pressure on Brady. Put pressure on Brady." My wife is a lady who knows more about football than most defensive coordinators because it's amazing how many people don't put pressure on Brady. And you guys see it. When you put pressure on him, he first of all, you can't blame him for not wanting to get hit, right?
Yeah, Brady doesn't want to get hit. And like I was saying, he's not a runner. And most of the routes that kind of Tampa Bay has, you need these receivers to get downfield. The last couple of weeks, they've been working Gronk in with some sort of stuff, which has worked out good. But you have to remember, Tampa Bay looked really, really bad. And the last couple of weeks, they have looked okay. But that's because the quality of teams they've been playing the last couple of weeks have really not been that good. So, you know, all these people saying, oh, Tampa Bay has been on a roll. I mean, if you look at the last two or three teams that they played, they should have beat those teams, you know, so I'm just not convinced. I know there's probably a lot of Tom Brady, you know, fans that are calling me a hater or everything like that. Look, the guy's good. I'm not arguing about that, but I think he's going to have some trouble with this Washington defense.
Well, yeah, if you look at Washington, they've been in a playoff game now every single week. Every single week. I mean, when you clinch at the very last game of the year, on the last Sunday night of football, yeah, you waited to the last minute. Those games were all pressure, and that'll make a difference, right? When we come back from break, we're going to hit Wild Card Weekend Sunday. Three more games. Really, I'm pretty excited about this weekend. Three games Saturday, three games Sunday. You're listening to Sports Betting Weekly on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network and Belly Up Sports Podcast.
It is the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
At championshipfootballs.com, they offer a 100% money-back guarantee on every single souvenir football that they sell. The coolest present they'll open that day, guaranteed. There's nothing worse than trying to find the right gift for somebody that already has everything. Whether that special present is for a New England Patriots fan or an Ohio State Buckeyes backer. Maybe Grams is a lifelong New York Giants supporter. Or your brother-in-law is a 12th man living in Seattle. Know a member of the Michigan State Alumni Association? Is there a better Father's Day gift for someone who's a Baltimore Ravens fan? Send them the coolest present they'll open that day, guaranteed. Now, if your favorite pro team is the Buffalo Bills or those Minnesota Vikings, well, they're sorry about that. Also, if you're a New Mexico State Aggies or Tulane Green Wave alumnus, not much they can do. After all, the name isn't nice effort, you had a pretty good season, footballs.com. The name is championshipfootballs.com. The coolest present they'll open that day, guaranteed.
Hey, this is an important message. I'm Second Half Chaz from Sports Betting Weekly. Sports betting is supposed to be a hobby. It's supposed to be fun. If you're hurting yourself by gambling with money you don't have, check out our website for the Gamblers Anonymous phone number.
When Vince Young scored on 4th and 5 in the 2006 Rose Bowl, two things happened. The Texas Longhorns won the NCAA title, and championshipfootballs.com was born. From Texas to Alabama to Ohio State, and now for Super Bowl winners too. Championshipfootballs.com is the place for the coolest present they'll open that day, guaranteed. Now, 10 years later, championshipfootballs.com has the autographs too. See if any of these names remind you of a special time in your football life. Michael Bennett, Lou Holtz, Joe Montana, Devin Smith, Jameis Winston, Rocky Blyer, Rocket Ishmael, Ara Parsegian, Mike Stonebreaker, Chris Zorich, Luther Bradley, Todd Light, Tony Rice, Lawrence Taylor, Dave Casper, Marcus Mariota, Rudy Rudiger, David Tyree. Enter the promo code RADIO and you'll instantly save $50 on any of the championshipfootballs.com autographed footballs. championshipfootballs.com. The coolest present they'll open that day, guaranteed.
It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Sports Betting Weekly.
You keep lying when you ought to be truthing. And you keep losing when you ought to not bet.
And that really is why you should listen to Sports Betting Weekly. Because you could be losing bets you shouldn't be making to begin with. It's not bad handicapping. There's certain situations you shouldn't touch. And again, I give Wes kudos all the time. Because Thursday night, get rid of it. Sunday night, get rid of it. Monday night, get rid of it. NFC, get rid of it. You know, when he gets rid of 6 or 7 games, but guess what? Out of those last 6 or 7 games, he finds winners. And that's what we do here. We find winners. And if you want to be a winner, you got to send your email to show@sportsbettingweekly.com. It's a show, and we're called Sports Betting Weekly. So the email is show@sportsbettingweekly.com. That one's pretty easy. Then in the subject, you just put the team you want. So I'm going to ask Wes right now. He's going to send the email later. But Wes, what is the name of the team you're going to have to win?
Monday night?
Yeah.
The Ohio State University.
And what do you think you're going to have for those two numbers after that?
I'm going to have 41-28.
They're pretty close to what I have. There you go. And then in the bottom of the body of the email, you just put your name. That's all you got to do. If you do anything less or anything different, I'm just going to delete it. I don't have time to be picking through social media to find scores. If you want to win this, and trust me, I have sold a lot of these display case combos. They're like a work of art, especially with the colors. The Ohio State colors are beautiful. Alabama's colors are beautiful. They'll usually have a special logo. About the only thing that's going to be weird this year, again, and I don't know if Wes was on when we talked about it with John, is it's got 8-0 for a championship. And I really think you got to go back to like the Navy of 1934 before you see an 8-0 championship game. But that's what it is. All right, Sunday, we've got three games. They start – now, all the games are the same. They're like 10 o'clock and then 1:40 and then 5:15 or 5:20 or something like that. Sunday, the first game is Baltimore at Tennessee. Now, Baltimore has is a team that I rode a lot last year, and I was shocked that they got bumped so early by the same Tennessee team. Now, I know for a fact these teams are going to score some points. I'm leaning Baltimore, but I'm thinking I like the over as much. And this might be one of those games where I pull out the old sixbetsagame.com philosophy and bet the overs, bet the team totals over, and just root for everybody. Participation trophies, there's nothing wrong when you got the over for rooting for everybody. So what do you think, Wes?
I agree with you. I think there's going to be a lot of points in this game. As far as the team, I really like Baltimore in this game. Three and a half. I actually prefer the 3.5 because when it goes down to three, it's more of a -120 type situation. But Lamar Jackson's throwing the ball better than a lot of people are going to give him credit for. And that Tennessee defense is very not good. So, I mean, that's the way I see it. And Baltimore is the number one rushing team in football. They're rushing in 50 different ways. They have a running back I named my son after from the Ohio State University, J.K. Dobbins, who's playing great ball. So this is a revenge game. This is a revenge game. Tennessee went in there and punched him in the face last year in a playoff game, and they weren't supposed to beat him. Baltimore was possibly the best team in the AFC last year, and so there's a little bit of that going on. I know Harbaugh hasn't won a playoff game in a few years, but the man's won a Super Bowl. He is a fantastic coach. He deserves to be there, and I think that Baltimore is going to make right last year's wrong.
John, what do you think?
I'm in the same situation. These teams know each other extremely, extremely well, and I would kind of say the same as Wes did with the redemption game, because last year Tennessee pretty much dominated them in that game, and I think they're going to be motivated. You got another year of experience under Lamar Jackson. He has been throwing the ball extremely well. I'm not – the way Tennessee has been playing is kind of, you know, so-and-so leading down the stretch. I like Baltimore in this game, like, you know, the 3 to 3.5. Anything more than that, I would probably stay away from. But I like Baltimore, and I do like the over points in this game. I think if you're going to bet the over in any of these games, I would probably be the one to go to.
Yeah, and this is, again, not only a game where you could have multiple bets, but this is a game where you could take those extended lines. What do they call those lines that are actually, like, given -7.5 when the team's given?
Alternative spreads, I think. Yeah, yep.
On both the over and both this game. But, I mean, Baltimore has some kind of incredible record, right, of 50 or 60 straight games of over 100 yards. Some sick, sick number.
Yeah, I think, you know, especially Lamar, I think he wants to kind of prove himself. You could kind of say it's been very lackluster performances for him since he's been obviously very short, you know, amount of time that he's been in the playoffs. But I think, you know, he wants to come out. He wants to improve. And just the same sentiment, you know, they really – if there's a team they want to stick it to in the playoffs, it's going to be Tennessee. So I look for them to come out, you know, early and really put some points on the board.
All right, so the second game, really 5-6 weeks ago, you would not think that you'd be watching Sports Betting Weekly on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network and the Belly Up Sports Podcast Network, and the word Chicago Bears would come out of second half Chaz's mouth. You wouldn't think that. But somehow, Their offense kicked in gear. Their defense played good enough. And even though they didn't win the last game, they're in the playoffs. They're playing the Saints. It's a double-digit game. You know what? This game, I looked at it a couple times, and I don't know which way I'm leaning, but it seems like the Saints shouldn't be giving anybody 10 points. That's what I'm thinking. What do you think, Wes?
I agree with you on that, but when you start to look at their numbers and they do beat teams, they flirt with 10 points and they do beat teams by more than 10. I mean, they've blown some team outs, and we can think of that Tampa game, and Tampa's a lot better than the Bears, and they blew them out. I struggle with this team because they played each other and they went into overtime, and that was a full New Orleans roster. The part of that game is it took three New Orleans Saints fumbles for the Bears to get into overtime. And Nick Foles also had to throw the ball 41 times. If Mitch Trubisky throws the ball 41 times, three of them are for 7 points, the Saints. So I struggle with the 10, because with the Bears, if you were to take the Green Bay losses out, the Bears are only averaging losing by 6 games in their losses. So this is a widespread of odds. It can either be 9.5, 10, 10.5, no matter where you look. This feels like too many, but I still like the Saints.
Well, John, as you know, we talked about the book is pretty good at establishing those numbers. And how many times over the years, you know, you three of us have been talking for years now. How many times have we said a game looks fishy and then on Monday it didn't look fishy, it looked clear as a bell?
Yeah, you're exactly right. There's a reason why these bookmakers and everybody are so good at their jobs, because this is why. This game right here, this is a classic look but don't touch for me. You know, I'm going to watch this game. I'm going to enjoy it and see. The 10 and a half, your first instinct is to say take the Bears, but then it's like probably I think the Saints will probably wind up covering that, just because I just don't trust the quarterback play. The Bears are solid defensively. They have a pretty decent running game, but I just don't trust the quarterback play at all. Kind of what Wes was saying, if they're forced, you know, to throw 35 to 40 plus passes this game, they're going to be in a lot of trouble. I just don't see it. A high scoring game, I think the Saints will probably take this one. But for me, yeah, classic look, but don't touch.
When we talk about it, and Wes, you mentioned it, we talked about it with the Rams-Seattle game. This is a situation where the first two things you look at, I'm going to rephrase that. The first two things I look at when I'm trying to analyze a team in the playoffs is coaching and quarterback. And in this case, the Saints get both those check marks.
They do. The other piece that really jumped off the page for me is the Saints are averaging right around 5 yards a carry in the last two games. And, you know, two weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, it was Kamara that ran the ball 6 touchdowns. But then he's out, and they turned around and they fed another running back for over 100 yards in 18 carries. So that tells me their O-line is playing pretty fantastic ball. So I'm from Chicago, so this pains me to say it, but the Bears, I feel, are going to get mollywopped in this game.
Yeah, but you're not Bears, Wes.
Well,
so you know what? You wouldn't be saying that if it was the Blackhawks. We'll talk. Mm-hmm.
Well, I grew up on the ice. I grew up a hockey player. And the Blackhawks, we've hoisted 3 cups in recent history. I even had gray on my hair when we did that. I can't remember the last time the Bears did that for me.
No, it's been a while. All right, so then the final game, and it is a rematch, right, of a game that was just played. It's Cleveland and it's Pittsburgh again. Now, I think that I'm not quite sure. First of all, there were people that bet against Pittsburgh last week. Cleveland was given 10, and not only did they lose, they never, ever recovered. Not one time in the 1 minute of 60 minutes of football were they covering that spread. I personally think this may be the easiest win of the weekend. I think this is, again, opinions, but what is sports betting before the game start? It's all opinions. My opinion is that I'm not a big Roethlisberger fan. I'm just saying the guy got a week off. I think the quarterbacks that took a week off, coming back next week, we're going to have 2 more of them. I think those guys have a big-time advantage because they didn't have to get ready physically. They just have to get ready mentally. And when you're playing a conference team for the third time And we always say it's hard to beat a team three times in a year, but they don't have to beat them a third time. They just got to beat them a second time. I love Pittsburgh enough that I'm going to key a lot of my plays to Pittsburgh in open parlays, hoping getting some of those second half plays, maybe a few first half plays. So the very sixth game, the very last game of the weekend, is going to be a big game for me. I love the Steelers here.
I agree with you. I think if Cleveland's going to win or even be in this game, Baker's going to have to do it. Pittsburgh does not allow a lot of rushing yards. They have an incredible defense. Baker can use his legs, and he's capable of it. Pittsburgh's not as good from a pass defense standpoint as they are is in allowing rushing yards. They're fantastic against the rush. And what I worry about with Pittsburgh is the drop balls. These receivers are dropping balls left and right. I think Pittsburgh's easily going to cover the six, but I say I don't think Cleveland, if it was a more experienced head coach, a Pete Carroll and Andy Reid, that barely won that game last week, I would chalk it up to being strategic and not giving film and just barely winning and doing it the right way and saving your players. But this is a new head coach who is just not, I just don't think he's that clever. Great story there, but Baker's going to have to beat him with his arm, and he's going to spend at least four times on his back. Pittsburgh is going to win, and I'm the same as you. It's going to be the centerpiece of a lot of keys.
Hey, John, before we ask your opinion on that game, I got to just say that you got to give Baker Mayfield his props, because a little bit of controversy, a lot of commercials, but he did something with a team that really nobody thought he was going to be able to do. He made them a winner. They're a very good football team. There's no doubt about that.
Oh, yeah, he has. I kind of feel like Baker was almost put into a no-win situation. First of all, no knock on anybody who likes Cleveland or who lives in Cleveland, but, you know, you're going to the Cleveland Browns. You know, who was there prior to that? Johnny Manziel, right? So we all know what he was kind of stepping into. So, I mean, if you just look at his play, whether you like him or not, his play alone makes me like the guy. You know, I like the way he plays the game. Obviously, Cleveland is way, way better with him throwing the ball. There's no doubt about that. But I'm going to go make it a clean sweep here. I'm going with Pittsburgh, too. It's Pittsburgh versus Cleveland, and I'm going to take Pittsburgh 99% of those times. It's the quarterback, the coach. Like you said, Roethlisberger, sometimes the week off doesn't do players good. In this case, I think it does Pittsburgh wonders when they're stepping into this matchup. It's just, you know, maybe Cleveland maybe needs another piece, maybe just some more experience, you know, down the road. But I got to go with Pittsburgh here.
Yeah, and Wes, I cannot tell you how many games I was watching with people that had Pittsburgh when they were doing those drops. And as you know, sports bettors, they come in a gamut. There's the quiet ones, and then there's a lot of obnoxious ones, and there's the swearers, and there's the throwers. There are some people that throw things when their team doesn't do anything well. And Pittsburgh, really, that would change. If that's the case and they start the game with drops and it gets in their head, yeah, anything's possible, but I'm going to handicap it as if they're going to catch the ball, because that's your job. You're a wide receiver. Catch the damn ball.
They've been there before. Pittsburgh has been there before. That coach has been there before. He's been to Super Bowl. So has Big Ben. If they start with the drops, panic button, Cleveland money line.
There you go. And again, all these games you got to have live action on. If you're betting any football game, even basketball games, as we talked about with Kentucky, there isn't a sport out there. And that's what we're going to start doing next week when we get back together, is we're going to look at games that are live. So we're going to, probably in the first segment, we're going to make a play. And the way I do it is quite simple. I use covers. Covers tells me what people thought before the game and what's happening now. But covers is always about, I don't know, 2 or 3 minutes behind ESPN. Then I'll click to ESPN, and I'll see what's really happened, and then I'll make my decision. And there's really nothing better than when you can get a game, and maybe it was supposed to be an over, it's supposed to be an under, the one team's winning by 20, and they're given three, whatever the case may be. But by the time we get off the air, you've got a winner. Well, you know what? There's nothing better than that. And that really would be a reason why you would watch Sports Betting Weekly, because when you start the show, you have, or when you end the show, you have more money in your pocket than when you started the show. And there's not a lot of shows that'll tell you that. So, all right, so we're going to be out of here. We want to wish you nothing but luck. I want to thank my guest, Blackhawk West. Don't forget, John, too, it's got a brand new year and brand new deals. The stream, the little ticker at the bottom should give you the Instagram address. Check it out on Instagram. I'm Second F Jazz. You can follow me on Twitter. You can catch this show on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network app. You should download that app if you haven't, because they got some great, great shows. Same thing with the Belly of Sports Podcast Network. Nothing but great, great shows. I am Second Half Chaz. Thanks for joining us. Always be cashing.
Thank you, guys. Have a good night.
Yeah, have a good weekend, guys.